wisdom. In an elephant you sang, and I'm wrong. I'm getting water every day. I need you. You know I'll never break your heart. I hear you. Just out of my intentions, the heart that just makes me sad.
I Standard saying that says, don't read the comments. I read the comments. Just so that I don't like feeling good about myself. So, I have this brand new song. It's coming, it's for my new album, which is actually coming out. Believe it or not, it's a Discipline, Heal Thyself Part 2. Actually coming out September 14th. It was supposed to be out in time for this tour. Why we had this tour. But I forgot that it takes time to make records. By the time I got like out of my old record deal, because they basically took the record and they dug a hole, threw it in there, covered it over, and then said, oh, there you go, there's your album release. I said, maybe I'll wait till I can get out of that, put part two out. So I got out of that deal and thought, it's almost done anyways. And looked at my songs on my computer and went, it's not almost done. Some songs didn't fit, some songs I didn't like as much, some songs I needed to fix or retool, I wanted to re-sing, I wanted to rewrite some lyrics. Then I wrote a whole bunch of new songs. Conveniently for me, the world has gone mad. And I live in the United States now, and as much as like we share kind of similar accents, and we have dollars, differences. One of them was this march that they had almost exactly a year ago in Charlottesville, Virginia, where a bunch of white supremacists ended up killing a person and carrying patio tiki torches, which seemed funny until I realized they were yelling, "Jews will not replace us," which was not something. I'm a Jew. Not exactly. I wasn't there for the meeting when we said, "Hey, let's replace people." I did see Invasion of the Body Snatchers in 1976 with Donald Sutherland and Leonard Nimoy, and was not about Jews. Watched it again recently, still not about Jews. But anyways, these guys seemed to think it was. And it seemed kind of almost comical at first. And I thought, hey, well, I'm a Jewish immigrant to the United States. Very different kind of immigrant from the people who are coming from Central America, for example. Their immigrant experience is very different than mine. I'm a very privileged, middle-aged white man from Canada. But I was still totally freaked out by this and thought, I gotta write a song, which is not usually my thing. I don't usually get riled up and write a protest song, but I got, it just happened. And I wrote this song, so I wrote it, recorded it with The Odds, a Craig's band, and we put it out, and I saw this comment today on YouTube that said, well, it's a pretty catchy song, but you know, I think it's pretty weird to have a privileged white Jewish guy from Canada singing about an immigrant experience. I think it's very different from what people from Central America are experiencing. And I was like, was he at my shows? And he just repeated my exact banter before the song, except as a criticism. Where I was trying to say, I felt like I had a connection. I'm not gonna speak for anybody else. That's the problem with privileged white men, is we always think we can speak for other people. It's not my job. But I do remember my grandparents' generation, not long ago, on the continent that you're, for a limited time, still part of. So it doesn't seem as absurd as it might to somebody who has zero memory, I guess. So I wrote this song, and we're gonna use the Undertones pick as part of the rock. And as part of my protest, I will continue to read the comments and take them personally.
Rolling.
Dumped in the lake. start.
Sarcasm in the classroom. Teacher leaves.
Saturday. Something better and we live. What else do you need to push it for?
Thank you.
first made eyes on me.
Said all the great movie stars you've worked with. who's the biggest asshole? And he is like, just if you've seen him speak before, and you have this image of what Ron Howard is like, he's exactly like that. He's like the nicest man you could ever imagine. And he's like, oh, no, I mean, oh, everybody's, you know, they've got their own quirks, but no one was an asshole. And I'm like, no, that's a lie. Someone had to be an asshole in all the movies of work. Who's the asshole? And he went, well, you can't tell anybody this, but Wilford Brimley's not very nice. He was one of the guys in Cocoon. He was the old guy with the big mustache. And we were like, oh, I knew it. So that night at Madison Square Garden, the Kenny night, Ron Howard was there with his family, and so we told the whole audience. Ron Howard says the Wilford Brimley's an asshole! Haven't worked with him since. So I have to share the news for the right hand. Sometimes you might open the door at an inconvenient time at your house and you think it's a Jehovah's Witness. It's just me saying, hey, have you heard the news? Wilford Brimley did a bunch of oatmeal commercials in North America and he was in Cocoon. Asshole. No, I don't need to come in, that's fine. I just want to let you know that. That's all I remember about the Madison Square Garden show. But do I need to remember any more than that? Top falling forever, a fantasy, oh no, never. Winter in here, the corner skirt. Love song with some snow, the snow drop. To make you show. Wait till you hear the chorus girl. There'll be no waiting room. No, no cocaine disco.
Come away.
He's going to go like, into this big chorus, right? Where everybody's supposed to go. Cell phones are out and all that stuff, and people are like lining up to offer me like TV commercials and stuff for the song. And you guys are like, oh, remember that song from like 2018? Where it was like the sound of that summer. But I think just, either I forgot to finish it, or I was like self-sabotage, which is probably more likely, kind of ideal. Where I might have gone like, yeah, it's a lot of pressure to try and come up with that. Because the thing is, you know, I was talking about the Madison Square Garden thing. Like, that wasn't just based on a couple of those songs, but it kind of was. We got lucky. You know, I got lucky. I got so lucky to be able to be involved in a few songs that, like, connected with people in their lives, like, beyond me. It wasn't about me and the band I was in. It was just about those songs and where they existed on the radio. And, you know, the sound of the summer, and they're remembering that, and remembering, like, trying to remember the words and do the best part, whatever, and then their dad's doing it, and then they stop liking it, but they still remember it. And it was like, that was an amazing thing. It took me a long time to realize, like, what a great gift that was to have a song, or a bunch of songs even, that just people out in the world living their lives incorporated that into it. And it wasn't like, they weren't thinking about Steve. They were just thinking about that thing. How it made them feel. Left out. Or loved. Or together with other people. Or all alone in their bedroom. Or whatever it made them feel. And I was able to share them. And then you guys come to a show. And you sing some of those memories back at me. And it's an amazing feeling. And I'm so grateful for it. But I'm also addicted to it. So I want more. So when I have the opportunity, every song I write, I'm like, this is gonna be the one. I can't just go, this was great. Let's just keep going, loving life. I'm like, give me that thing again. Chasing the dragon, I think they call it. Although I'm scared of dragons. So I'm not really chasing, I'm more being chased by it. I'm not actually being chased by it, because if it was, I'd have another hit. Bad metaphor. Regardless, I realized I was thinking too hard. That it's not about pursuing that thing. The chorus is just for us. It's for us to sing together. For the three of us to sing together on stage. And the fact that you guys are here as part of it just makes it a bonus. So I looked inside myself. I looked inside the song. And I realized there was a chorus here. And there'd be a chorus here all along. I'll teach it to you.
Drove downtown, right?
Friday or Tuesday night. Just check out the late night record shop. Call it impossible, call it impossible, call it insane. When I'm surrounded, I just can't stop. It's a matter of instinct, it's a matter of condition, and a matter of fact. You can call me Pavlov's dog. Ring a bell and I'll celebrate. How's your night gone? Dr. Landy, tell me I'm just a paragon. Cause right now I'm
lying in bed, just like Brian Wilson did.
Well, I'm
lying in bed, just like Brian Wilson did. Whoa.
Shut up.